Whenever we have a subgroup of the general linear group NC, GLNC, of course this group acts on the affine space, the N affine space, but also it acts on the space, on the set, on the ring of polynomial functions or on the ring of polynomials. So the action usually is, I mean, you can choose the two different actions, left or right, but usually it's chosen this one because it will help to do something else we will see later. So the action usually is defined like this. The element of the group act on a polynomial via this composition. So we see the polynomial as a polynomial function and the matrix as a linear function. So when we have this kind of action, we can also extend them to the tangent, the cotangent, the canonical sheaf. I mean, once we extend it on the tangent, we can also define it on the on its dual and all the tensor wedge powers and symmetric powers. So the other thing I want to recall you, so there is something in the chat maybe. Okay. I don't know. Okay, maybe there is some question in the chat. Okay, so I was saying, if also the group is in SLNC, then it will preserve the canonical form of the affine space. So we know that there is a global well-defined holomorphic canonical form on the affine space. And it is preserved by subgroups of SLNC because they act on this sheaf as the determinant of the matrix, which is one by definition here. So again, another definition that I want to recall you is the definition of quotient. So whenever the group acts on the variety, we define the quotient to be the spectrum of the invariant polynomials. And in the case in which the group is finite, there is a bijection between the point, the closest point of the scheme defined here in the previous line, and the orbits of the action. So usually it is bijection with the closure of the orbits, but if the group is finite, it's the same thing. And another thing I want to recall you is that if the group is an SLNC, then the quotient has a trivial canonical bundle, whatever it means. So what I'm saying is that even if one does not know the definition of canonical bundle in a singular variety, there is something that has the right to be called a global N form, because the global form of AN would descend on the quotient singularity because of the property of preserving the canonical form. So in this framework, usually one can ask to itself if there exists a crepant resolution. So here there is another word, a huge word, which is the word of singularities. And in particular, these singularities are canonical, and one would like to know if there is a crepant resolution. So I will not go in the direction of the description of the singularity, but I will say you what is a crepant resolution. So a crepant resolution is just a morphism. We target the singularity with the property that the domain is smooth, the morphism is projective and birational, and so this is just a resolution of singularity. But crepant means that we ask the canonical bundle of the resolution to be the pullback of the canonical bundle of the singularity. And in particular, since I said to you that this canonical bundle is trivial, it's the same to ask that Y has trivial canonical bundle in this situation. So I want to also recall you what I mean by zero dimensional scheme, because sometimes in literature there can be some misunderstanding. So if I consider a semi-local Artinian k-dimensional C algebra of finite type, so this, the spectrum of this for me will be a zero dimensional scheme of length k. I'm going to explain in a second. And whenever the ring is local, I will call it fat point, the spectrum. I will call the spectrum fat point. So what do I mean by this? I mean a geometrical object which topologically is a finite set of points in the first case, or just one point in the second case. But the functions on it are, instead of being a one-dimensional complex space, so the set of constant function, I'm considering a full k-dimensional vector space of function on these points. So if you don't know what is a scheme, just to give you an idea. In the case in which one is not interested in all this detail, one can also consider the set of the group of degree k zero samples. This is something that you obtain when you forget about these vector spaces, but you keep the information of the dimension. So they are finite sums. So they are a point in the element in this direct sum. So they are finite sum. Integer combination of point of x, and you ask to the sum of the coefficients to be equal to k. So this was just an introduction to recall which are the basic tools of the talk. But let me go through the main characters, let's say, of the talk, which are the Hilbert scheme, and in particular the GILB of the affine space. So first, let me recall what is the classical Hilbert scheme of K points in the affine space, n-dimensional affine space. So is the as a set, so it is a geometry, it is a variety, but let me just describe it as a set, because it's a variety, it has a universal property, and today I don't have time to expand on this. So let me just say the definition as a set. So as a set is the set of zero dimensional schemes of length k, and in order subschemes of an on length k, and in order to give a subscheme of the affine space, you can do two different things. You can give an ideal sheaf with this property. So the dimension of the global section of the quotient is k. So this gives you a zero dimensional scheme. Or equivalently, you can consider the quotients of the structure sheaf of AN. But when you consider the quotient, you have also to put the condition, the equivalence relation given by the isomorphisms of quotients. And indeed, the two quotients are isomorphic if and only if they have the same kernel. Okay, so as I said to you, when you have a length k zero dimensional scheme, you can forget about the scheme structure and keep the information about the number, the dimensions. And to do this, you would find an element in the group of zero cycles of degree k. But there is also a geometrical object which parameterizes the element of the group. So as a set is the same of the group, but it has a geometrical structure. It is a very wild geometrical structure, but it has a geometrical structure. And this map, which usually is called the Hilbert homomorphism, is exactly the map that I was describing you. So you take a zero dimensional scheme of length K, and you forget about the scheme structure. You remember just the topological space and the dimensions over each point. Okay, but this is too big. And today, as you see from the title, we would like to talk about this G-ILB. But first, we have to define what is the ILB-G. So the definition here is that a zero-dimensional subscheme, so we fix, as explained before, a finite subgroup of SL, because we are interested in the Krepant resolution of the singularities. And we say that a zero-dimensional subscheme is a G-cluster if the ideal is G-invariant, so the ideal defining the scheme is G-invariant, or equivalently, the quotient is G-equivariant, so the structure sheaf. G-equivariant means that the action of the group over AN lift to the sheaf is the same thing I was saying about the tangent space, if you want. But the other request is a request on the link between the C of XY module structure of this H0 and the group structure. So the second request is that the global section of the structure sheaf are isomorphic to the regular representation as representations. So what does it mean? I will expand on what is this CG. So for the moment, let's say that it is a fixed representation. And this isomorphism means that we have an isomorphism of vector spaces, which between these two representations of the group, which induces a commutative diagram where the horizontal arrows are the actions, And the other vertical arrow is identity times the isomorphism that you have on the right. Okay, very well. So one can show that this condition one and two are closed condition. So the subset of the subset ILB G defined by the G cluster is a closed subvariety of this variety above. Again, I just give you the definition as set. And one has to prove actually that these two conditions define a closed subvariety of ILBK AN. But still, this is not what we want, because this ILBG may be reducible, and so it would not provide a Krepant resolution of something which is irreducible. So let me give some example of G cluster just to understand what we're going to do. And these examples will play a central role. So the first example is that if we take a G cluster and we forget about the scheme structure, so we take just a topological space without even remembering about the numbers, then we find a G orbit. And this is a consequence of the first point. While a consequence of the first and the second point is that if we take a reduced G cluster, so a G cluster which is reduced without forgetting about nothing, then this is a free orbit. So what I'm saying is that the only possibility to find a sheaf supported on a zero dimensional schema with this property, which is also reduced, is that the support has to be a free orbit. And the last example that is a toric example, and toric examples we will see are very important, is very, let's say, classical example. So we consider the group generated by this matrix. And of course, where C3 is a primitive third root of unity. And clearly this group is isomorphic to the cyclic group with the three elements. Well, if we consider now the spectrum of this CXY module, this is a G cluster. So this C of XY module is a local ring, Artinian local ring. It has dimension three. So let's see, the first point, the ideal is G invariant is true because the ideal is, the M is the maximal ideal. So the ideal is generated by monomial and the group is diagonal. So it's very easy to show that the ideal is G invariant. And then you have to see that there is this isomorphism representations. So first, let me decompose the group as a direct sum of G invariant subspaces. Indeed, the monomial subspaces are G invariant, again, because the action is diagonal. So we can decompose this C of XY module as the sum of three vector spaces, the one generated by one, the other by X and then by Y. And if you see what happens to each of them, let's see, on X, the group act, you have to see the first entry of the matrix acting this way. So here I'm cheating in the minus one way, because if you remember the first slide, it would act with minus one, but in any case, let's pretend there is no minus one. The theory is the same. So if I act on X, the matrix act by multiplication by this number, this complex number. On Y, so on the vector space generated by Y, the group acts by multiplication by the other root, while over one, since one, the constant function composed with everything is the constant function, the group acts trivially on the first entry. So in particular, this group is acting in a different way on the three entries. So this will be the sum of three different representations. And as I will show you in a few slides, this is exactly the regular representation of the cyclic group. So just give me some time, but now you can see at least that the three representations are different. So in any case, we use the first two points of the example to define this irreducible subvariety of ILBG. Which is defined as the closure of the free G orbits. So we take just the component which contains the free orbits. So now we can consider again this horizontal map that we have on the on the top in the top of the page, and we can restrict this map to GLib. And if we collect everything, what I've said up to now, we notice this is just an observation that if you put here the space of orbit, so let's say just set theoretically the set of orbits, this diagram commute. Why this is important? Because in 2001, Ridgeland, King, and Reed proved the following theorem. So if n is 2 or 3, then the morphism below, so the horizontal map below, is a crepant resolution of singularities. So this is important because, let's say, this is the sharpest result in the sense that in dimension 4, GILB may be singular, or GILB may be singular, or the crepant resolution may also not exist. In the paper, they also proved that there is they proved also some derived equivalence between two derived categories, but I will not go into the details of it. I will just focus on the crepant resolution today. So another thing that I want to say, that the theorem is particularly interesting in dimension 3, because in dimension 3, we know that the crepant resolutions, so resolutions in general, crepant, which are minimal in some sense, are not unique. So one would like to construct all of them. And this, in a certain case, was done. And so we need a generalization to do this, which is exactly the notion of constellation. So let me go through that. So again, we take a subgroup, a finite subgroup of SL and C. And we say that a coherent sheaf is a G constellation if, first, the sheaf is G equivalent. So again, we insist on the condition on the sheaf, because here there is no ideal, there is no more an ideal. And second, we ask that the global section of the sheaf, the global section of the sheaf over AN is isomorphic to the regular representation. The space of global section is isomorphic to the regular representation, again, as representations in the sense that I explained before. There is an isomorphism of vector spaces, which induces an isomorphism of, a G equivalent isomorphism of vector spaces. So let me give you some example, just to have in mind some example of constellations. Of course, there are trivial examples. For example, the structure sheaf of a G cluster is a G constellation. And this is exactly the definition that I gave before. So instead of F, you put O of Z. But then we also notice that if we consider the support of a sheaf, so the set theoretic support. So let's say the point where the stock of the sheaf are different from zero, then this support is a G orbit, and this follows again from the first point. And again, from the first and the second point together, we discover that if a G constellation is supported on a free orbit, then it is the structure sheaf of the free orbit, or better, it is canonically isomorphic to the structure sheaf of the free orbit. So the interested part, so the heart of the study, will be when we study constellations supported on non-free orbits. So constellations supported on point with non-trivial stabilizer. So let me conclude with the analog of the example of before in this case. So again, we consider the same action, but now a different C of XY module, which is an ideal inside some quotient of the polynomial ring. And again, you can do the same decomposition in vector spaces as before. So for X and Y, nothing changed, because the action is the same. So the vector space generated by X and Y are exactly on that vector spaces, the action is the same. And over X times Y, the group acts as the first entry times the second entry, which is 1, because C3 is a third root of unity. And again, we have, this representation is the same representation associated to 1, so that we had before, the representation generated by the vector space generated by one. Therefore, this representation is the same as before. Still, I didn't say you exactly what is this CG, but if you want, it's just the vector space generated with basis at the element of G, if you want, just to have something in mind. And in this case, again, we found the same representation as before. So maybe are there questions? Okay, so I will go through the construction, so the definition of the moduli spaces, which will be the Krepant resolution in dimension three. So just one thing, many things may be also defined for G in GLN, okay? It's not mandatory to define with SL, but if we look for Krepant resolution, we impose this condition. So let me introduce the notion. So the game here, the trick here is to introduce on the, let's say, the set, but it's not exactly a set, but let's say to introduce a notion of stability condition, GIT stability condition in the sense of king. And then when we construct, I will define everything, but just to give you an idea, when we construct the moduli spaces of stable object, we will find the Krepant resolutions in this way. So let me go through the definitions. So let me start by saying that I will use this notation for the set of isomorphisms of irreducible representation group. So every group has irreducible representations, which are vector spaces on which the group acts, and they cannot be then some of different smaller and proper representations. And then we also consider this Grothendieck group of the representations. It's something that may sound hard to be understood. So formally, this is the this RG with these two operations is as a group with the plus is the Grothendieck ring of the isomorphic classes of representation of G. And then I will explain in a more easy way in a second, but just let me formally say what it is. So this zero means a Grothendieck group, but we also introduce the ring structure, so this multiplication, because if we have two representations, we can tensor product them. And then we know each representation is written uniquely as a direct sum of irreducible representation with some power. So we can write again an element. We obtain again an element in the Grothendieck group of the representations. So, but if you don't know what is the Grothendieck group of the representation, you can just imagine that you are considered the free abelian group generated by the irreducible representations. It's known what they are, I mean, irreducible representations. And then there is this notion of tensor product that you can understand at least for element in this group which have positive coefficients. Indeed, element with positive coefficients in this group correspond actually to representations, and if you tensor product two of them, you will find an element inside there with positive coefficient. So at least you can understand the semigroup inside here n to the power if g. Okay, why I'm saying this? Because now I can say you with CG. So as a vector space, I say to you, as a vector space, CG is just the vector space with basis the element of the group. But as a representation, it's as an element inside this group here, is the element which has in each entry the dimension of the corresponding irreducible representations. So in particular, if the group G is abelian, this vector would be the vector 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, because all the irreducible representation of an abelian group are one dimensional. Okay, finally, we can define the space of stability condition. So the space of stability condition is defined as is an hyperplane inside this vector space. So we consider the vector space with over the field of rational numbers. This is the vector space of homomorphism, of group homomorphism from RG to Q. So if you imagine RG as column vector with this length. So this home group would be the vector spaces, vector space of row vectors which act on the columns. And you take an hyperplane, as I was saying, imposing this condition. So theta against computed on the regular representation has to be zero. So in the abelian case, we ask that the sum of the entries of theta has to be zero. So for the same reason, this hyperplane has this dimension, is isomorphic to this vector space. And so now this is really something classical that was done around 94 in this famous paper by King. You can define the stability, GIT stability. You can do this for quiver, you can do this for a C of XY module, you can do this for G constellation by saying that if you take a G constellation and a stability condition, then this is theta semi-stable if the first condition, which I put zero, is that theta of f is zero, where by theta of f, I mean by definition theta computed in the global sections. And from now on, I will, with a Poisson notation, interchange the f. I will use the f to denote the h zero, because we are on a fine space and they are actually the same object. So I was saying why this condition is zero. Well, because this condition is always satisfied, because this H zero by definition of G constellation is isomorphic to CG, and theta of it is zero by definition of theta. So this is always verified. But in a second, you will understand why I'm saying this, because second point is that for any proper G equivariant subsheaf, you ask that theta on it is greater or equal in the semi-stable case than zero. So if you know other notion of stability, you can look for some comparison between theta computed on a smaller object and theta computed on a bigger object. So you say that the bigger object is theta stable if something, some comparison works holds true. And indeed, the comparison is that this zero is exactly theta of f from the zero, the point zero. So really, actually, really you are comparing theta computed on f and theta computed on e. So usually in other stability notions, that is smaller, in this you have greater, but you can do the same theory inverting the inequality. And we will say that stability condition is generic if theta stability is equivalent to theta semi-stability. So the two conditions are equivalent. We will say we'll see in a moment that these are very important conditions. But let me give again another example. So let me work on the examples that I already gave. But first, just let notice that the structure sheaf of free orbits are always stable for any parameter, just because they don't have proper G equivariant subsheaves. So suppose that you have a free orbits and you have something one dimensional supported on each point, you cannot take a subsheaf of it, because if you act with the group and you have removed something, then this would not be G equivariant. So there are no proper G equivariant subsheaf for the free orbits, so they are always stable, because there is nothing that can contradict this point one. And now the example. So again, I took the same constellations as before, the toric constellations, and I will say what toric means. Sorry, it is two monomial, let's say, constellations. And the two parameters, there's a minus 2, 1, 1, and 2, minus 1, minus 1. So let's see what the definition says. First, we want to, so why is, so theta 1 has three entries, because again, the group is zeta modulo 3z. And so, as I said, the reducible representation have dimension 1. We have three reducible representations, and so we have three entries for the stability parameter. So now we have to compute all the proper G equivariant subsheaf of F1 and check if theta 1 of them is positive and if theta 2 of them is positive. But there are not so much of them. So the first, let's see for F1, if a submodule, so a subsheaf which corresponded to a submodule contains one, then it is all F1, because one is a generator of the quotient, right? The map is surjective from the polynomial ring to the quotient. So a proper G equivariant subsheaf cannot contain one. So it will contain X, Y, or both X, Y. And if you remember, X corresponded to row one, Y to row two, and the sum to row one plus row two, of course. And so you see, row one corresponds to the vector 0, 1, 0, E2. Row two corresponds to the vector 0, 0, 1, which is the, let's say it's the third irreducible representation, and then we have the sum. So if you compute this vector theta 1 against this vector, we see that theta 1 against row 1 is 1, theta 1 against row 2 is 1, and against the sum is 2, so it's positive. So F1 is theta 1 stable. Let's see with F2. With theta 2. Theta 2 against row 1 is minus 1, same thing for row 2. So F1 is not theta 2 stable. You can play the same game with the subsheafs, G equivariant subsheafs of F2. And there are three of them. But in this case, you can have row 0 alone, because XYC alone by itself is not just a subvector space, is also a sub C of XY module. While if a sub C of XY module contains X, then it would contain also X times Y. So if it contains a row one, it also contains row zero. And if it contains row two, for the same reason, also contains row zero. So there are three possibilities, and you can check that these are the only F2 is not theta one stable, but it is theta two, in fact, stable. So now we are ready to state the theorem about Krepp-Ant resolution. So first, some fact which follows from the works of King and Bridgeland, King and Reed. And the facts are that this space of generic stability condition is a disjoint union of chambers. You can read here, they are convex, open convex polyhedral cones, but they are disjoint chambers. And why are they important? Because in each chamber, the notion of stability is constant. So if you take two parameters, theta one and theta and theta prime inside the chamber, theta semistability is equivalent to theta prime semistability. And there exists, for any generic theta, a moduli space of theta stable constellation, which depends only on the chamber. So let me repeat. For each generic parameter, there exists a moduli space of theta stable object. And these moduli spaces are isomorphic as moduli spaces. And I don't want to go into the details. If you want, I can, but it's a long story, but they are isomorphic if and only if they are on the same chamber. What happens is that if you take two parameter in the same chamber, theta and theta prime, theta stability is equivalent to theta prime stability. So the third point, the third property here is that there exists a chamber such that that moduli space is isomorphic to the G yield. So the variety from which we started, the first Krepp-Ant resolution I gave you, is one of the, is the moduli space of one of these chambers. And the fourth and last point, these are just facts that follows from the other paper I said to you. The Hilbert homomorphism, so the map which associated to each constellation is support, which again take values in the singularity, we saw this, is a Krepp-Ant resolution. So now the problem is, are all the Krepp-Ant resolutions obtained in this way? And in the case in which the group is abelian, there is a positive affirmative answer by the theorem of Cohen-Dish, which proved that in the three-dimensional abelian case, all Krepant resolutions are isomorphic to some moduli space for some chamber. Okay, so let me go in the direction of my results now. I started to work on this because, as I said to you some problem in dimension four, and clearly the problem remains open, the situation in dimension three in the non-abelian case. So I wanted to understand this, and I had in mind to prove some theorem that will be the last theorem that I will show. And I found some interesting for proving this theorem, some useful property that I'm going to show you. So the first thing that I proved is that for the action of the cyclic group over A2, so the cyclic group is the only example of abelian group, there are exactly k factorial chambers. So to be honest, it was said to me after that I put the article on archive, it was said to me that you can also find this result following a different way, different from mine. So this is not quoted yet in the paper that you find online. But I will update it. I'm just saying that there is another proof of this, but not a proof. There is the possibility to prove this via another way. And this is a consequence of a work of Kronheimer. But it is a consequence, you don't find there the computation. So, but why I'm saying this? Because this computation allowed me to define some particular combinatorial object, which helped me in describe all the chambers. So let me go through that direction. So first of all, the fact here is that for a finite subgroup, even not abelian, of SL to C, there exists a unique Krepant resolution. And here there are two statements. The first statement is that there exists a Krepant resolution. And the second is that Krepant. So the existence of a resolution, the existence of a unique resolution is a matter of, the existence of the Krepant resolution is because we are working with the SL to C, so it makes sense to ask this. But the fact that the resolution is unique is a matter of dimension two. So we know that this kind of resolution for surface are unique. So let me describe this unique resolution for you. And so we start by this picture. So the singularity is on the right and the resolution is on the left. The exceptional locus is a chain of P1s. So the exceptional locus is a preimage of the singularity, which is isolated. Sorry, I forgot to say the singularity is isolated. And both the variety here are toric varieties, and X has just one toric point, which is the singularity, while Y has all these toric points, you know, because P1 has two toric points, let's say zero and infinity. And so they mutually intersect in one toric point. The P1s mutually intersect in one toric point. So the other thing that I want to recall you, I want to stress on this because I already said it, outside from the exceptional locus, we know everything about this map. So whatever structure of moduli space you put on Y, you know that inside of it, there will be free orbits, right? Because we said that this map associated to a G constellation is support, and over a free orbit, there can be also only the structure shift. So what I'm saying is that outside from the exceptional locus, we see always the free orbits. This doesn't depend on the moduli structure we put on Y. So what changes is exactly what happens on the exceptional locus, in particular over the toric points. I will show you that it is enough to know what happens on the toric points to know what happens on all the moduli space. So let me give you the definition that I promised you before, which is the definition of G constellation. So a G constellation is toric if it is torus equivalent. So what does it mean? A2 has a canonical structure of toric variety, which is given by the diagonal torus. And as you can see, the group G is a subgroup of the of this two-dimensional torus, so C star square. So a constellation is something which is a G equivalent, and I also asked it to be torus equivalent. The proposition, the observation, the proposition is that the toric G constellations are exactly the constellations which correspond to the toric point of the moduli spaces. So over the, so these moduli spaces parameterize G constellations, and over the toric, their toric points, we can see the toric G constellations. So, there is a, when you work with something which is toric, toric equivalent, there is a, the machinery of the Ferret diagrams, or if you prefer a Young tableau, starts, no? People use this object. So let me introduce very briefly them for you, and I will go through picture because really the definitions are quite involved, but very easy to be given with the pictures. So, there is an abstract version of this definition and a non-abstract version of this definition. So just read this for the moment, ignoring the bracket. And so a G-stair is something, a skew-Ferret diagram, I'm going, a skew-Ferret diagram, and I'm going to say in a second, contained in N2, associated to a toric G constellations colored with the element in Fg. So what is this object? First of all, it is a subset of N squared. So for example, something like this, where instead of using pair of natural numbers, we use monomials, no, which is the same. Then skew Ferret diagram. So we know what is a Ferret diagram. Maybe you know Young tableau, the name. So it's just a increasing pile of rows of decreasing width. So a skew Ferret diagram is just the set theoretic difference of two of them. So in this picture, the blue is a Ferret diagram, the red is another Ferret diagram, and the skew Ferret diagram is exactly the picture that you see, which is the set theoretic difference of the two. And but this is not a G-stair, because the because I didn't finish it. There is another part of the definition that I will add now. So G is a G-stair. So I mean, the definition is correct, but the picture is not a G-stair, because I said that it has to be associated to a toric G constellation. And so this implies, it's a proposition, that the following property holds. So if a monomial belongs to the diagram, then the right up box, upper box and the lower left box does not belong to the diagram. So the picture, the diagram you find at the shape on the right. And as you can see, they are similar to these stays or snakes or someone. But the, I mean, the definition that I gave is a G state. Okay. Why? Let me give you also an example, because I didn't say you the difference between abstract and non-abstract. So the non-abstract are really are subset of the of N2, while here I should find a way to put under bracket this gamma, because actually the abstract is not a subset of N2. And here there are the pictures. So the three of them are associated to the same G constellation, because as you can see, they have the same dimension as vector spaces, because the dimension corresponded to the number of boxes. They have the same C of XY module structure, because this corresponds to the diagram to be the same shape, but they are also the same as representation, because the obvious isomorphism of C of XY module also induces some isomorphism of representations. So let's say that the box labeled with zero goes in zero, the box labeled with one goes in one, and so on. While the abstract version of these diagrams is just one, so there is just one abstract G state for any G constellation, and you just see the labels, and you have many ways to embed it in the natural plane. Okay, so these are the G states, the combinatorical object which describe the G constellations. Okay, let me describe. So as I said you in the picture before, they live on this P1, they are zero and infinity on some P1. So let's try to understand if two G states can be on the two toric points of the same line in some moduli space. So here there is this huge proposition, but it's very easy. Again, I will use pictures to explain you. So the problem here is given two G constellations, which are given two G constellations, there exists a moduli space, so a chamber in a moduli space with a chamber, then you consider its moduli space, and then there exists a curve in this moduli space such that these toric G constellations are over zero and over infinity. So here is written, so the proposition that I proved is that this is possible if and only if first the eighth of their G states has to differ by one unity. So this means that if you want to hope that this can happen, you have to choose two of them which differ by a unity. So for example, height, it means what you think. So the height is the number, the height. So for example, for gamma here is 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. And for gamma prime is 5. So we can hope that they live on the same line. And the proposition is that, yes, they live on the same line if. So there are two versions, equivalent, the two propositions are equivalent. I just packet them. So we ask that if we take the shortest, we construct this increasing linking stair, which is constructed in this way. You take the shortest and you glue a copy of it below the last box on the right. So you see there is a copy of it on the glued below the last. Then you cut, you do this right vertical cut, which means you take, you cut the diagram with the vertical line and you take K boxes on the left. You see here the action of course is zeta modulo 9z, z modulo 9z. So you take 9 boxes. And as you can see, you find the other constellation, gamma. So we started by the shortest and we find the tallest. So gamma prime, we started by gamma prime and we found gamma. You can see it's the same. Analogously, you can do the other version. You take the tallest. Now you glue not below, but on the right. And now you cut horizontally and non vertically. Again, you take 9 boxes and you find the other. Of course, there are many vertical cuts that you can produce, and different cuts gives you different lines if you want. So you fix a constellation and you find all the possible lines, families of one of constellations supported at the origin inside some MC. I want also you to notice that from, if we consider just the part of the linking stair, which is the union of the of gamma and gamma prime, they always intersect properly. Properly means that they have boxes in common. This is a trivial, no? Because they cannot be disjoint. So I used this observation to build this combinatorial object called chamber states, which are the union of all the G states appearing in a chamber. So let me show this for you. And why this is important, because instead of having many objects to describe one chamber, we will have just one object. So you take a chamber and you construct the chamber state by taking all the G states, all the G states of the C stable G constellations, and you glue them along the common part. And you build the abstract chamber state. And of course, there is a non-abstract version of it. So this is important because this allowed me to define the notion of simple chamber. And to do this, I need the notion of generator. So let me go step by step. So given an SFD, so a Skew-Ferré diagram, we call generators of the diagram the boxes in the lower corner, and we call anti-generators the boxes in the top corners. This name comes from the fact that, of course, the boxes of the generators correspond to the generators of the XY modules, while anti-generators correspond to the so-called, so the smallest submodules inside the module. So this is a picture, and the definition now is that a chamber is simple if there is a G state which has the same generator in the chamber. There is a G state which has the same generator as the chamber state. So for example, if I take the previous example, the generators here are 4, and there is no zeta modulo 5 constellation which has 4 generators. So this chamber wasn't simple. And why simple chambers are important? Because first, I remark that there are this number of constellation, which is very few with respect, so k times 2 to the k minus 1, which is very few with respect to the k factorial chambers. But now, the theorem that I proved is that every toric G constellations appear in some simple chamber. If the simple chamber is chosen in such a way, the generators of the G state and the generators of the chamber state are the same, then there is a unique chamber which verifies this property. And finally, there are half simple chamber than the number of toric G constellations. So if you want just to have a picture of the constellation, so know which are the G constellations, you don't need to see all the chambers, but you need to see just the toric, just the simple chambers, not all the chambers. So this is just an example. These are all the shapes of the chamber state for this action, and these are the simple chambers. So it's just a picture. So I'm going to finish, but as I promised you, the theorem that gave me the idea of proving the previous part of work on the previous part was what I'm going to introduce. So first, while working, I discovered this proposition that was exactly something related to what I wanted to prove. And the proposition is in this celebrated paper of the two authors. And it says that if we consider the quotient, so again, G is, as usual, a finite subgroup. We don't ask here to be abelian, but if you take the quotient singularity, so the projection over the singularity and the Crepant resolution, and then you push forward the destructor shift of the affine plane, and then you pull back what you find in quotient by the torsion, the result is locally free of rank the cardinality of the group. The proof of this passes through the fact that this push forward of the destructor shift is reflexive. I generalized this property by proving that if the group is abelian and you take any monomial coherent ideal shift in the destructor shift, the same result is true. But what is not true is that the push forward is reflexive. So I had to prove it in a different way. So why this is important? Because first of all, this K tilde is very easy to be written on the charts and to be computed with the computer software. But it is also important because it allowed me to prove the final theorem, which is, so first a fact, just to recall that the fact that the universality of this moduli spaces that I didn't expand too much for you, but just, so I give as a fact that there exists a vector bundle called the tautological vector bundle over each moduli space, that over each point has exactly the vector space, the corresponding vector space. And even more, it has the corresponding G constellation. So it has a C of XY, this object is also a C of XY module, and it is also a representation. So the theorem is now that if you take one chamber state for the chamber C, and we take the corresponding the monomial which correspond to the generators of the chamber states, then the locally free sheaf that I described to you before is the tautological vector bundles, is the tautological vector bundle that I was talking to you. So if you want to have a complete picture of the situation, and even in the non-simple case, you want to actually construct the universal family, because maybe for some reason you know the generators and you don't know the family. I mean, can changes, it depends on what you want to do, but you can do this very explicitly writing the equation for this module. And let me conclude with this example, just to picture, showing you why in dimension three this doesn't work. Sorry, I forgot to say that, of course, different chamber state would give isomorphic families, and this is, okay, let's say that this is not so important. We have 1 minute for the example, and let me spend this minute for this example. So, this in dimension three, as I said, to the Crepant resolution is not unique. For example, here there are two Crepant resolution of the singularity A3 modulo Z modulo 2Z squared. So even if you don't understand the meaning of this picture, this is a toric picture, and you just need to know to understand the example that to each triangle correspond to a toric point of the resolution, hence to a toric G constellation. As to give the family, I have to give you a family, I have to give you the toric objects, that they will be toric, they will be G equivariant, but we will see that they are not necessarily G constellations if you don't do the correct procedure. So the picture is here is that this is the GILB for this action, but if I try to do this push-pull modulo torsion with the same sheaf on the other resolution, I find something that on the two toric points that I didn't touch, nothing changed. But when the flop happened, you see, I find something which is torus equivariant because it's generated by monomial, is G equivariant, again, because it's generated by monomial, but it is not a G constellation because the group has cardinality 4, while over the points you have something which has cardinality 5. And indeed, you can construct, you can do the opposite game with a sheaf which is good for the solution on the right and not on the left, and indeed, this sheaf that you see in the title is good for the right and not for the left. Indeed, on the right, all the point have, of the toric point correspond to G constellations, four dimensional vector spaces, while where the flop happened, you see we have five boxes here. And so I conclude here. Thank you.